Just like we did last.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's United Methodist Church. Be sure to check in on Facebook right now if you're joining us online. Also, lift up your prayer request in the comments, and we will try to get all of them during our sharing of the prayer time. Is anyone here for the first time today? If you are, please raise your hand.
All right, we got some inviting to do, right? That's right.
If you are here for the first time, please raise your hand as an usher will bring you a welcome gift. If you're joining in person today, please take a moment to fill out the slips, the attendance sheets, which are at the back end of the pews. And you can also lift up a prayer request on there also. There's also a spot for your email as well if you'd like to get our weekly newsletter and what's going on in the life of the church. Finally, take a look at the back of your bulletin to see our announcements of what's going on in the life of the church. We have lots of stuff going on, and you'll want to be a part of it. And now Pastor Matt will have some other announcements.
Thank you, Catherine, and good morning again, everyone. As always, immediately following worship, we have fellowship time in the chapel with coffee and refreshments. And wow, I have some great stuff to lift up today, some exciting stuff. Today we're excited to announce, as we did last week, that our nursery is up and running for ages infant through 4 years old. Now, if you'd like to take advantage of our nursery care, or you invite somebody who has children or little children, invite them to our nursery care as well so they can go and meet the wonderful caretakers that we have there. But if you are here and you'd like to take advantage of our nursery care, one of our ushers is happy to show you where it is, and it's right around the corner from the sanctuary and down the hall. Also, you know, we're looking to hire people for part-time for this position. So if you're interested in this and know someone who would be interested in nursery care, please let me know. It's going to be from about 9:15 to 11:45 on Sundays. We're paying $15 an hour. Come let me know, or let Mary Ellen know, who's in the back of the sanctuary. Mary Ellen, would you throw your hand in the air? Thank you. We're going to lift up thanks to all who came to our church cleanup day yesterday. We had a wonderful group of volunteers, and we had a lot of fun, and we worked hard to keep the St. John's building looking beautiful, both inside and out. Thank you so much to all who came. And thank you also to Art and Rosemary, who made our wonderful breakfast burritos. Finally, today in the gathering room at 10:45, after our fellowship time, we are going to be down in the gathering room, which is out these doors and down this hallway. We're excited to launch our new children and youth Sunday school program for the fall. Our launch party and meet the teachers and helpers as part of this celebration, we're all going to be down there. And then also as part of this celebration, we're going to have a special project making seed bombs that we encourage everyone to take part in. And these seed bombs are going to go to reseed the burn scars in our area. And we thought this would be a really neat church-wide project that everyone could take part of. And we're also going to be handing out free admission tickets to the Children's Museum. Thanks, Children's Museum. You guys rock. That's awesome. Also, if you look just over there to my right from here, that's our new Sunday school class for our children's ministry. Go ahead and poke your head in. It's a really cool class. They've done such a good job getting it ready. And also, finally, I'll be starting a new Sunday school next week. We're going to be meeting in the library, and this is to coincide with our new Sunday school, children's Sunday school program. It's going to be a new opportunity for any parents or adults to come together for Sunday school and have just one more option. Well, these are all of our announcements for this morning. If you'd like to keep up with what's going on in the life of the church, be sure that we have your email so we can put you on our email list for the weekly e-news that comes out on Wednesdays. All of that is wonderful, but it's not necessarily worship. So let's turn our hearts and our minds, our bodies toward worship this morning. We're beginning a new series. It's all about grace. And we're going to be learning in particular about this thing called prevenient grace. Maybe you've heard that word before. Maybe you haven't. Doesn't matter if you have or not. If I do my work right, I think we'll explain it and grow together because of it. So let's now turn our attention to worshiping God. Let's center ourselves during our prelude and prepare our hearts to be open through the word, through prayer, through scripture, through message, through singing together, through being together as God's people.
Please rise if you are able and help with the call of worship. Sing to the Lord a new song today.
Let all of God's children rejoice in God's love.
We love because God first loved us.
Let us who search for God with the same zeal that God first sought us. We worship God whose grace comes before us.
Let's turn to 365, Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
Calvary's bowed down pole.
Our first scripture reading this morning in your bulletin says that it is Philippians 2. We're actually going to do Philippians 2 as our second reading, and our first reading is going to be from the book of Hosea. And so I want you to listen to this story and this listen for the way that God describes the relationship that God has with God's people. Listen for grace. Listen for a God who is present.
When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priest and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over to Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim. For I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. They shall go after the Lord, who roars like a lion when he roars. His children shall come trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like the birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria, and I will return them to the homes, says the Lord.
As we enter into a time of joining our hearts together in prayer, I lift up today first the memory, the honoring, the remembrance of September 11th, as today is September 11th. Let us join our hearts together, and I lift this up in prayer for our country and all of those who still, after this many years, still so feel acutely the attacks on those days. So let us join our hearts together for those who mourn, for those who suffer, and remember in our collective conscience to lift and raise each other up as a nation, but as a nation of God, a global nation. Also, I lift up prayers of thanksgiving for healing for me. I've been sick, medically released, still feeling a little tired, still feeling a little foggy, but I appreciate your prayers, and I ask for your prayers for my continued healing and just getting my step back. So are there other joys and concerns that we want to lift up in the body today? Yes, Al. We lift up prayers of thanksgiving for the moisture. Able to get more affordable car insurance. Amen. What a help, right? Yeah. Joan. We lift up allergies. I'm feeling you this morning, sister. Donna. We lift up prayers for Barbara Sharp and her husband in his recent fall. And you said stroke, so I guess it's determined that he's had a stroke, and his continued healing and recovery and strengthening, and prayers for Barbara and all of the caretakers that surround him right now as well. Thank you, Donna. Sal.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Sal. We lift up continued prayers for our Bag in Hand food pantry. Prayers of thanksgiving. Prayers of thanksgiving for so many hands coming together to be the hands and feet of Christ, and just how much that ministry has grown thanks to its wonderful leadership and reaching out and reaching in as well. Others. Yes, Frank. Okay, we continue to lift up prayers for Frank's niece, who, yes, around this time last year suffered a brain bleed, and we were in fervent prayer throughout her recovery, and she is recovering and still suffers from not being able to see out of one eye, and so we lift up ongoing prayers for her continued recovery. Are there others? Yes, Ken. Yes, sir. We continue to lift up prayers in that same vein of 9/11. Those who continue to suffer from that tragedy here and now. Those who were running away from the danger and those who were running toward the danger and suffer the ongoing effects in their health. Yeah. Others. Yes. Sharon. Okay, we lift up prayers for Sharon Kirkpatrick and an upcoming surgery on her ankle this week. Any others? Okay, we lift up prayers for all of England in this ending of quite an era and a brand new season in the loss of queen and the new reign of a king and what that will look like. We pray for all of England in this time of great transition. Yeah. The others? Yes, sir. Okay. We lift up prayers for honesty and integrity in all of our elected officials, and also honesty and integrity in the upcoming election process. Hey, who's feeling a little anxious about that? Yeah. Yeah. We lift up prayers for the anxiety. We lift up prayers all throughout this country for our upcoming elections, but electoral process and all that's going to go into that. We lift up prayers of, yes, we lift up prayers of thanksgiving for a new Sunday school launch, and we also lift up prayers for the ongoing discernment how we can be at our best to serve our children and youth and serve with our children and youth. Amen. Any others? Whew, lots to lift up in the body today. That's good news. So let's go to God in prayer. And let's join our hearts together. Will you join with me in silent prayer? Great and precious, Most High God, we humbly come before you with hearts open before you. Lord, I thank you for the so many voices that we have had this morning who have led in this worship service as examples of saying, I need prayer. We need prayer. Lord, hear our prayers, those that we have said out loud, those that we have kept within our own hearts. Hear our prayers of thanksgiving. Prayers of thanksgiving for healing of nations coming together. Lord, hear our prayers for the anxiety over nations being torn apart. Hear our prayers, Lord. Help us remember your presence has been here, is here, and will continue to be here. Help us remember your steadfast love guiding us, guiding our steps one in front of the other, literally and metaphorically in our faith. Help us, Lord, come to recognize you in brand new ways. Come to recognize the ways that we have fallen away, that we have not been at our best, that we have not done your will or practiced your love. Help us to be vulnerable and bold in crying out to you. Help us be mended back together in the beautiful ways that only you can provide salvation and be the great sower of faith. And that you can be the great sower, sowing us back together. Help us, Lord, remember that we are your creation, that we are precious, that we are made in your image, and it is your will and good pleasure to have us be and do your will, to be your hands and feet in this world in all the ways that we are capable of being. Help us, Lord, find all the ways that we can to unite in you and set that as the foundation of our hearts and our lives. Help us with the words that we say. May they be more than just words that we say on a Sunday. The powerful, centering words of your Son, Jesus, as he taught the disciples when they asked him, "How do we pray?" And he simply said, "When you pray, pray this way." So we remember today that you are indeed our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers forward, and as they come forward, I'd ask Catherine to lead us in another prayer.
Please join me for the offertory prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, thank you that by you all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible. You warned us not to store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal, but to store up treasures in heaven. Guard our hearts and may we, in bringing our offerings to you now, store up treasure in your kingdom. May your peace, which surpasses all understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, in your powerful name. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand and sing the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, above heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thank you, choir. Whew, I'm still kind of out of breath. I'm telling you, this sort of brain fog and fatigue, it's for the birds, y'all. I just got to say, like, you know, if in my sermon today, if I drift off, kind of just know that it is the Holy Spirit alive and working in me and... It is God's grace working in me. Well, let's continue in our readings. We turn now to Paul's letter to the Philippians. We're going to start at verse 5, chapter 2. And the first part of this, I want us to mainly focus on the second verse, or the last part of the verses, 12 and 13. But just listen to this beautiful hymn that comes about. Let the same mind be in you, all of us, that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we can say together, thanks be to God. Will you pray with me one more time? God, I thank you for your life-giving words as given to Paul, given to the Philippians. Help guide my heart and all of our hearts along your path and words. Let us understand your grace more deeply, not just in our head, but in our hearts, in our hands, in our feet. May the meditations of my heart upon your word be worthy in your sight, Lord. Help me be careful to give you the glory. Amen. So if you haven't picked up on it yet, today we are beginning a series all about grace. And it's about how we understand and explain grace as United Methodists. We understand grace in three major ways: prevenient grace, justifying grace, and sanctifying grace. Woo! Who's fired up to hear those words, right? Okay, those are kind of heady and stuffy terms, though we're going to make them more personal to us in this series. Because grace is very personal, while it is also absolutely global and given and extended universally to all. God's grace. Grace is God's love for humanity, made known probably most obviously in Christ. Grace, when it is received, both communicates forgiveness and makes renewal possible in our lives. It helps us to understand that we are God's creation, made in the very image of God. And our pursuit in life is to be restored to that whole image that typically we've distorted through sin, through falling away. See, grace is not just simply one generous act by a judge showing mercy on you. Grace is not simply the act of Christ dying and rising again for you. It's not just those things. Grace is also a process involving the constant presence of God, the Creator. God, the Holy Spirit, whether you recognize it or not, whether you accept it or not, God is there in all God's forms for us. God wants more for you than just pardoning of your sins. God wants you to be continually and eventually completely transformed, reclaimed, renewed. How grace, this gift from God, comes about in your life is in three ways. In your creation, in God's forgiveness and your acceptance of it, and in your continual transformation and recreation. And I definitely leave room for more than just those three ways. But those are three really important ways. In United Methodist, we don't stand on one side or another about which idea is more right or more wrong or which one should be emphasized more when it comes to grace. We believe in all of these ideas and support all equally. We believe in the work of God and salvation and the work of humanity and receiving it. You can't have a full picture of the extent of God's grace without one of these parts balancing it out. The different ways to look at grace can be a little tricky to understand, and I'm grateful for John Wesley, our founder of what we call Methodism today. He explained grace and salvation using the image of a house in three parts: a porch, a doorway, and then the rooms of the house. And today, we're going to look at the porch and look first at this first part of grace, something we call prevenient grace. Everybody, say the word prevenient grace on the count of three. One, two, three.
Prevenient
grace. All right, don't worry about that word so much after this. Don't worry about remembering it. It's a word used to explain that grace is present, alive, and comes before we even know what grace is. Not only is that grace alive, it's active in the presence of the Spirit that is always trying to draw you in, to woo you. It is God at work trying to make God's presence known. One place where Wesley, and I think we too, can seek to understand this in Scripture is from our passage in Philippians today, the last couple of verses, and also in Hosea. It's one that Wesley touches in on in a sermon titled, basically working out your own salvation. But first, Paul in Hosea, or in Philippians, Paul writes out in Philippians a beautiful and now famous hymn about who Jesus was, is, and will be for all of creation. But the last portion of the verses, it turns the focus on the people and pursuing their salvation, working out their salvation, all under God's guidance. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, meaning awe and wonder. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for God's good pleasure. Whether you know it or not, God is at work in you. God has been at work in you from the very moment you were created. No matter how you believe, at what point your creation began, God was there. You were not born and God said, "See you later when I or you feel the time is right." That's why today I also wanted to look at the book of Hosea to see maybe some prevenient grace at work. Hosea is a fascinating book of the Bible. It's the first book of the 12 minor prophets. And it can be a tough book to read chapter to chapter because how Israel is portrayed is striking. And it's not imagery that I particularly like or go to because of how it degrades, especially women and children. I think on our Bible study a couple weeks ago, we determined this was one of those like Jerry Springer shows of the Bible, you know, the book of Hosea. It's a bonkers book. But the story goes like this. The story goes that God told a prophet named Hosea to go and take a prostitute for a wife and exploit her further by lifting her up as an example of how far Israel had fallen and was practicing idolatry by siding with the Assyrians and relying on the Assyrians for salvation rather than for God. And Hosea, he was then commanded to have children, the first being named Jezreel, which means God sows, and in this case, sowing destruction. And another child then named Loruhamah, which means not pitied, because for a time God seemed to not show pity to Israel's destruction. It's a crazy story. And it's in these moments that I have to keep in mind that these are metaphors to show how far God's chosen people had fallen, what their consequences were, and the hope of God bringing the people back to life and helping them start again. While the story points out how and why Israel will fall, there's this passage that we read today, this beautiful reminder in chapter 11 of God's long-standing compassion for God's people. This part of Hosea we read today shows how God doesn't abandon the people. This part shows God's walk in compassion with the people before, during, and after all the ways the people turn against God. God was there in the beginning with the Israelites, despite disastrous acts and lack of faith. God still reached out and wanted the Israelites to do the same. Like the book of Hosea points out, though we mess up the image of God in us through sin, God still pursues us and wants us to be made whole. And God reaches out. God's love and compassion for creation endures through so much rejection by God's people, whether that's Hosea's people or us here and now. Well, here and now, where prevenient grace comes in, is that not only does God still have this compassion and love and grace for all of us, God offers it out, protects you, tries to show you that there is a better way. God tries to show you presence and guidance. Prevenient grace is the explanation of God's love poured out on all creation and God actively wanting us to know God. But prevenient grace is also the moment that you realize that you were lacking in the means of providing for your own salvation and that God's presence has been there. So like the Israelites and the Philippians, we have a choice. You have a choice in all of this to recognize and see the ways that God has been present in your life, the ways that God wants to be in your life, and provide a salvation that you cannot provide for yourself. Wesley would call this the porch. So on the porch, you can have a house without a porch, but you can't have a porch without a house. This house of salvation has a porch. If you look at different kinds of grace as parts of a house, you have a choice to move toward the porch and see that there's something special going on with this house. Right now, here in worship, I want you to picture yourself as one who's chosen to walk onto the porch because something has drawn you onto that porch. Get a porch in your head. Maybe it's one from your childhood. Maybe it's one that you like now. Maybe you've been on a tour of homes and you go, I want that porch. But put yourself there. Whether you come in through the front porch or the back porch, you typically have a porch or a stoop before the door. As you wander up to the porch, you begin to try to understand how something so much bigger than you, God, is present in your life. You have the free will to choose this life in Christ and move further into the house. You might not. But for now, you're looking at the porch and you want to go up. For whatever reason, you're curious. It's alluring. You creak up those stairs. You start walking around that front porch. You hear your steps clickety-clack on the wood. You hear the creaky sounds, letting you know that this is a porch that's been around a long time. It shows its ages by the noises it makes. But you also know at that time that you're on very sturdy ground. Every creak you hear, I'm trying to make the floor creak, it's not working. Every creak that you hear, that you make, it tells a story of a time that God was there, helping, saving, showing love and an infinite amount of patience. Every sound you hear from that porch is putting the pieces together in your head and heart that you were not alone in this world, that you were loved dearly in this world. And you see this because no matter what has led you to that porch, you see that you were created special, that you were carefully crafted in an image that is so much bigger than you, so much bigger than the image and identity that you have created for yourself up to that moment in time. But you also hear in the creaks this conviction, convicting you because it's coming to you, coming to light in the ways that you have suffered through sin and caused pain for you, for others. the ways in which that beautiful image has been distorted. You realize that you've sinned, that you've not done the will of God in some ways, maybe a lot of ways. But you begin to feel differently about this sin, like you want to do something about it, but maybe you don't even know what. Or you don't know if you can because you feel so weighted down by it. Well, I'd say in this moment, don't worry about that, because this porch will support whatever weight that you're bringing on it. Sometimes we sit on the porch. Sometimes we wander around the porch. Sometimes we hop off the porch and do some more exploring around the house or away from the house. Well, these are all metaphors for our faith lived out in prevenient grace. This balance of having both love and pain pointed out to you begins to show you that you aren't alone, that you can't ultimately save yourself. What can really save you is going to the door and walking inside the house and living in God's house and seeing the world from the inside of God's house of salvation. Now, I don't want to get too far. The door, that's next week where we're going to focus on the door. But for now, you're on the porch and you see the door. And you become more curious about walking through the door and what's behind the door. You need so much more than just wandering aimlessly. You will need action to get to and through the door. You can't get into the rest of the house until you make sense of the porch. If you don't explore the porch and understand why you're on the porch, the rest of the house just won't make sense. It won't be a genuine understanding of the house. And here's the reality. Some will approach the porch and wander around and eventually get to the door and into the house, and some will not. This gift of grace, this house of salvation, is offered freely to all who would enter. And hopefully all who have entered the house help make it and keep it very approachable. But we all have free will. We all have a choice. So how come not everyone gets to experience this salvation? Not everyone will recognize how God is working in their lives for salvation and recreation in this world. And some, honestly, will just outright reject it. We need to help the people pointing out this grace on the porch, like Paul, like God through these words of Hosea. We need to be the examples of showing the goodness of God's grace. If we are the ones who recognize and embrace God's grace. Like faithful others who've been through the door in the house, they be the ones who want to join them, who reach out and bring them in. Reach out to the people that you see around the porch and ask them, why are you on the porch? They are guiding you as well, pointing out all of the times of God's presence in your life. We will all encounter the judgment from God. Every single one of us. But God provides so many opportunities to get to know that righteous judgment as a celebration of God's love and power, not destruction and fear. Now, you can wander on the porch endlessly. You can step off the porch and keep wandering, or you wonder, not you're wandering. But you can wonder on the porch. So out of all of these scenarios, where are you right now? Are you wandering on the porch? Have you perhaps wandered back out onto the porch? Maybe stepped off the porch? It can certainly happen. But once you've been on the porch, you don't forget it. You can't. This porch draws you in. You step onto it, and it leaves a memory with you, even if you step off it again. The Israelites, of course, remember God's presence is eternal. They remember the times and can point to the times that God saved them and the times that they fell away. You can too. Prevenient grace doesn't end when you accept this God into your heart and life fully either. You always have the reminders of God's presence and your need for grace that you can't conjure up on your own. And you need to continually accept that grace for you and for others. This grace is radical, and it can be difficult to understand when we see how that grace is extended to even us, even you, even others. And we'll live sometimes like, you mean that person has grace extended to even them? Yep. It's us who limit the scope of God's grace. We can't help it unless we've been truly blessed with the opportunity to catch a glimpse of God's grace and explore genuinely what it does for our lives and the lives of others. Do you understand God's grace in this radical way today? It's important to know the answer to that question in your life. And the porch helps you understand that. So let's get on the porch. Whether we're getting back on the porch or we're coming to the porch of this house of salvation for the first time. Maybe you've been through the door, this justifying grace. Maybe you've been going throughout all the rooms in the house, which will be sanctifying grace. And the growing in your understanding of grace. I'll allow it. Maybe you're completely lost and say, what's with all of this house talk? The preacher isn't making any sense at all. Well, no matter where you find yourself, come to this porch and ask around about this grace stuff and what makes it so important for you and for others. Use the questions in the bulletin to guide you in some of this. Ask them to yourself. Ask others these questions and see what their response is. For those joining in online, you know what? In the comment section, I'm going to go ahead and put these questions up after worship. Help remind me if I forget. I got the fog brain. No matter what, it takes just a spark of curiosity to lead you to this sturdy and faithful porch. And it will lead you to the door. Until next week, hang out on the porch with me. The Philippians, the Israelites of Hosea's time. Let's ponder together all the ways that God has been present in our lives and what God wants to do with us next. And if you're still confused about this image of a house and salvation, come talk to me and I'll break it down in a different way. But it's well worth the conversation because we're talking about your salvation and the salvation of all and God's radical grace behind all of it that is continually present. So let's keep working through it as we have fellowship in the chapel after worship, as we make seed bombs together down in the gathering room after worship. Those seed bombs are going to bring new life to a fire-scarred area. Now, there's another good image for God's work in us too, right? Okay, I don't want to throw out too many metaphors and images. Let's just say amen to being on the porch. Sound good?
Amen.
Amen. Now, at this time, I'd like to invite forward the McGavern family. In the United Methodist Church, when someone steps forward and says, we want to become members, we want to make this our home, this people our home, we basically give the equivalent of a holy, yeah, buddy. We don't have a vote, we just say, welcome. But before that, what we do as a congregation is we make commitments to each other. And so, McGavern family, Alethea and Ken, I ask you in front of this church family, do you promise to support St. John's in making St. John's your home through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, you'll say, yeah, we do. Yeah, buddy. But we're not done yet. St. John's United Methodist Church. This wonderful family has come forward to be received into this wonderful family of God. And so I ask you, in front of this family, in front of all of your brothers and sisters in Christ, do you as well make a commitment and a dedication to support St. John's and this family through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, you'll say amen.
Amen.
Welcome, family. Welcome. If you haven't had a chance to meet them, be sure that you get to know them a little bit. They're a wonderful family. And now, let's rise as we are able one more time, and let's sing together. I want you to be I want you to be two-brained in this hymn. I want you to sing this hymn, but I want you to be singing it from the front porch. Listen for the other voices who are singing about Jesus softly and tenderly calling. And be sure that your voice is heard, because someone else needs to hear it in this place today. Song. Now, is that a good song to sing from this porch or what? So go out from this place with hearts full and ears listening for Jesus softly and tenderly calling you to come home, and also be a part of that voice of calling others home as well. This is a wonderful house to be a part of. Don't let anybody miss the opportunity. So go forth from this place, emboldened in God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, and God. God, Jesus Christ. See you in a minute. Let's go make some seed bombs and get some refreshments. Amen. You may be seated.